Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for coming to the second annual Miami Loco Poetry Slam. It's very quiet. It's a little too quiet for a slam, so you guys are going to have to do a better job.
Yay!
Encouraged to make as much noise as possible for things that they like. That includes stomping, snapping your fingers, clapping, making weird noises through your nose, if that's something that you're into. Whatever you need to do to show your appreciation for the poets, because these poets work hard. It takes a lot of guts, a lot of spine, lots of things to get up here and share yourself with an audience. There are 5 secret judges. You won't know who they are, except that they have whiteboards on their laps. Judges are going to be giving their scores, and they're gonna try to remain as unbiased as possible, and they are also going to try to not be swayed by the audience, but as an audience, of course, it is your prerogative to try to sway them with the noises that you make. So let's say that we have one of our judges, we're not gonna pick one out, but let's say that we have one of our judges, and we're afraid that our judge isn't going to give the score that we want. What are you guys gonna do about it? That might be like a 2.3 increase. You do better than that? Let's hear it. Come on, let's see it. That's better. All right, at this time I'm going to invite our performing poets to come out on the stage so that you can get to know them better. Performing poets, please come on out. Or come onto the stage. From my right.
Hey, thank you.
Your left. Oh, it will be Laura Stenerson. Let's hear it for Laura. Cassandra Davis competing tonight. Moon Thomas as well. Laura Lockinets. Jessica Dune. Sergio Lahore. And it wouldn't be a poetry slam without Cleopatra. Thank you, competitors. We're all inspired by your bravery, and now I'll ask you to go somewhere and hide. So poets have a limited amount of time to present their work. They actually have 3 minutes. We have scorekeepers in the audience. Scorekeepers, if somebody goes over, please do not notify the poet in the moment, but while the score is being tabulated, please let me know so that I can accurately get that score from you.
That's poets. The timekeepers.
Timekeepers, yes, thank you. Timekeepers. I guess I'm the scorekeeper. The timekeepers. For every 10 seconds that you're over on your poem, a slam poet will be deducted 0.5 of a point off of their total score. There are 5 judges in the audience. The best score will be dropped because we don't trust you. The lowest score will be dropped because we don't trust you. So we'll take the sum of the middle scores, the middle 3 scores. If any judge would like to raise their hand and share with the audience what qualifies you to be a judge in this competition. Mr. David Abbott, anonymously tell us what qualifies you for this competition.
I showed up.
David showed up. Yeah. He's now qualified to judge in this slam poetry competition. Any other judge want to share what qualifies you? You know poetry. You might be overqualified. Wonderful, wonderful. Any other judges like to share what makes them especially qualified? Yes.
I'm breathing.
You're breathing. I like that answer. That was a pretty poetic answer. I like that. Excellent. Wonderful. So the form of slam poetry actually started in the 1980s in Chicago, and it was begun by a construction worker named Mark Smith. before we get to the actual rounds of judging, there will be three rounds. The first round, we'll eliminate three of our poets, unfortunately. We'll see them go. We'll send them off. And our second round, we'll lose two more of our poets, so that the final round will be a competition between the three remaining poets. But we need a calibration poem. We need a slam poet to come up here as the sacrificial lamb of this competition, so that our judges can see what is a slam poem, in case they have no clue, which is entirely possible at this point. And so this will be our baseline poet. When you're thinking about the poems that come after this, you're gonna say, was it better than that first one? Was it worse than that first one? And you get to be the judge. All right, everybody. The sacrificial poet of this poetry slam is none other than local legend, Libby Rudy.
Not rise, there would be no day. Calendars would lose their yoke, clocks would need to be recalibrated, not a soul on the planet would not notice if the sun did not rise. Inversely contrary to the sun, if the moon should disappear, its absence could be not noticed. Night would still be night. The lack of a moon rise could pass without concern. In a star-studded sky, a slight shift in the wee hours, a hiccup in comparison to if the sun did not rise. I am the moon. I am not the sun. A cow jumped over me. Coyotes howl their lonely elegy to me. The dark side of me you will never see, because I am the moon. Unlike the sun, my light is soft and subtle, my presence not always acknowledged. The cause and creator of my loneliness, aloneness, unconnected. Ness is a word in Hebrew. It means a miracle. An act of the creator lacking logic or reasonable explanation. You said, I'll never hurt you. I answered, you can't promise me that. It's not in your hands. And I was right, and you were wrong, and there were so many miracles that happened before and after your passing. That paper that I wrote on Zen philosophy and relationships, it turned into an essay about loss, about not trying to hold on, about embracing the now with no expectations for tomorrow. I wrote it in a frenzy, my dizzy head spinning, my full heart beating. Only 3 weeks later, you died. I wrote about loss as if I knew, and I didn't. All I knew was that I loved you. I am the moon. I reflect the light of others. I remind restless insomniacs that in the quiet of restless night, there is rest for those who can let go. My sorrow is held in the silent heartbeat of eternity. I am not the glaring sun. I am only the soft and gentle light of the moon. The dreams that people dream while I move across the sky would be forgotten by sunrise. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Libby. So judges, that is our calibration poem. Try to avoid score creep, the continual kind of upping of the score as things go on. Always think back to that poem, that first poem that you heard on this stage tonight, to determine if your judging is fair. All right, we're gonna go into our first round of competition. I would like to re-welcome to the stage.
Wait a minute.
What did I do?
Wait a minute, they have to judge me.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And it's all right.
All right, so let's go through our first round of judging. At this time, while the judges tabulate their scores, I would like to remind everybody that poetry is expression from the heart. Sometimes it involves dark themes, uncomfortable themes, difficult subject matter, so parental guidance is, of course, recommended. So let's see if we have any scores. 9. Just one decimal point, David. No fractions.
You have to convert it from the 7.5. 8.5.
Okay.
9.5. What is that? Is that a snowman?
It's a snowman, yeah.
Okay.
You knew.
9.8?
Yeah.
All right. Did I miss somebody? Oh, no, I didn't. So we're going to drop our 9.8, our highest score. We're going to drop our lowest score, 7.5. We have a 9.5 and an 8.5. That's 18. Plus 9 is
28.
Right?
27.
I don't know. I warned you guys. That is it 27? 27. Congratulations, Libby. And now it is time for our first round of competition. Drawing the number one out of my sweaty hands was Laura Lockinette. Come on up.
They asked me where I buried the bodies, how far down they'll need to dig before shovels echo against hip bone and dirty manicures poke out of the soil like tiny mushroom heads. They asked me how it's even possible for someone my size to carry so much weight, but most of the time I dragged them, cutting trenches behind me like slithering eels, slowly filling with water and threatening to pull us both into the reeds. The first one I left in the attic under the crib. When I was old enough to move into a big girl bed, when I realized that smiling will get me further than crying, so I stuffed my mouth full of pillow until I never cried again. 5-year-old me I pushed into a train. She needed to learn that the world doesn't always stop for you. The next time was when grown men started yelling at me on the sidewalk. I carved myself up with a steak knife, keeping the flesh on ice to throw over my shoulder as I ran whenever the wolves started to bay. I was 12. I looked like I was 10. At 20, I learned my lessons hard and fast. I was a rock star, aging prematurely from the booze and pills. It was too easy to make that one look like an accident. But I couldn't stand the thought of her in a cold freezer. So I curled her up under the trees next to the little ones. They looked like they were just sleeping, and I hope they're dreaming of a world where bad things don't happen to good people. At 24, I had no excuse. I just wanted to kill again. Murder has become like a bad habit, like dyeing my hair after a breakup. I will not go quietly. I will kill again, and I want you to know that this is not a victimless crime. I always take somebody down with me. I don't pack up my belongings and put a for sale sign in the yard. I just burn the whole damn thing down until there is nowhere left for my ghost to live. I'm telling you now that you need to run. I will start kissing you with my teeth. I will trickle down your throat like shotgun shells, and I will leave you like an exit wound.
Thank you very much, Laura. Judges, please have your scores at this time. Nine. 24.5. Is that true? Anybody? Pretty sure it's 24.5. Thank you so much, Laura. We're going to move on to our... Oh, yes, absolutely. A very good score, a respectable score, a score that's going to be tough to beat. Let's see if our other competitors are up for the challenge. Next up, we welcome Cassandra Davis to the stage.
I am burning. There is a fire inside me, a fire flickering, torching my insides, begging to be let out, pleading for the destruction of all laid out before me. I am a fire, an embodiment of rage, uncontrollable, powerful, a bringer of death, and the harbinger of rebirth. I am a vessel for fire, the only containment between peace and chaos. I will not let it out. I will not let it burn. My tongue is constantly licked with flames, and each breath is harmonious with the sparks igniting in my lungs. I am like the perfect contradiction. I can control the uncontrollable as long as I am in control of myself. But such perfect control brings with it pain, instinct against morals, nature versus nature. I am always burning inside. The uncontrollable cannot be tamed, and if it is not out, raising the land to ashes, then it is wreaking its havoc inside of my chest. I am feared by others, but I am afraid of myself. I am powerful, yet powerless to stop the incineration in my lungs. I am danger personified, yet too cowardly to make anything of it. More a feared myth of what was once respected than any actual threat. I am a dragon, too weak to be anything more than a fly.
Thank you so much, Cassandra. Judges, tabulate your scores. We have 8.4, 7.4, 10, 9, and 0, 0.
I didn't see mine.
I didn't see it.
Yes, you did.
What?
The desk.
No. 25.8. 25.8.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, the incomparable Ken Bo.
Flunky that hung out at the original slam in Chicago. Well, this thing's kind of cool. Is this working?
Yeah, yeah, sounds
oh,
good.
Look at this little thing. I'm going to read from the menu here. By force of forest. There is a mesmerism of remembered light in what we call imagination, how fantasy reorganizes the hypnotic structures of recollection. There is the glimmer of hope, an eagle flying above today's failed efforts at beginning a new project, even as it's torn out of the last project. The projection falls on the wrong wall, revealing a doorway plastered over. I had not been aware of this other side to myself, knocking around in my waiting. Categories frighten like footsteps as I write this list, then another list, an endlessly long hallway. I don't want to pit which way to turn against another way to turn. Each room filled with precious emptiness, an illusion brimming with false reprimand. I think of childhood, like an old paper tiger, prowling the wrecked cars strewn across the floor. The forest is larger than the fear of it staring you down, moving sideways off the trail, over the mossy, clean slices of tree stumps, where something was cut down before its pathology matured, and the hand had pointed, and the hand branched out. A slip of wind through the thoughts come back as color in the leaves of fall. Each leaf a map of a forgotten world. Each dint of daydream cracked open by thoughts in the sandbox. An unreasonable universe. An ambidextrous amnesia. Clawing two-tone past the warden.
Very much, Ken. Now we're gonna go to the judges. We have a 7.6. We have a 7. We have a 9.75. We have an 8. And we have a 7.5. I will use the calculator because you guys are getting very into the decimal places, which I'm excited about. I'm very excited about it. 22.5 for Ken Bo. Next we have my favorite and yours, Laura Stenerson.
I'm wearing red for Ed, and I'm walking out on Thursday. Strike, 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 strike.
Yeah.
Teachers across the nation are raising to change the system. We've said no more, no more, no crumbling infrastructures, no more buying materials with our own resources. No more uncompensated pay. No more making ends meet. We're saying no more. Public education is dying a slow, slow death, and with its death comes the death of democracy. The gap. No, the chasm. No, the damn Grand Canyon between the haves and the have-nots. What about my students? Don't they deserve the same resources as those kids in Scottsdale? Yeah. Strike, strike, strike. But this is about our children. Make no mistake about it. I look at them and their unboundless potentiality, but they have no chance. They don't have the chances. Teachers, we always get by. We always get by. Low pay? Oh, we can make ends meet. Buying those materials? These are for my students. They deserve them. Crumbling infrastructures? Well, just take care of that rat. No, our kids need more than that. Strike, strike, strike. I'm a copper miner's daughter from this town. I know what strikes are. I hear the word scab. Don't cross that picket line, scab. Don't cross that picket line. And I remember the strikes. And I remember the worry on my mother's face. And wait, I remember. Strike? Wait, I don't get paid. Wait a minute, I'm just a teacher, and I just go from pay to pay. And my students, I haven't graded their altered books, and we haven't yet made that roller coaster out of paper. And the eighth graders, they're gonna do something. They're gonna do an art installation. And hey, my daughter's getting married in July. And strike. I don't get paid.
Thank you, Laura. We're gonna go to the judges. We have a 10. 10. 9.25, 10, 8.4. Wow. Just want to double check with the timekeeper.
Yeah, we're good.
Thank you. No offense, Laura. Just checking. There we go.
Oh my God.
Ladies and gentlemen, the cat has arrived. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for our next competitor, Sergio Lepore.
So that's why I want to share it. It's called Tribal Cracks. It's one of my newer pieces. The body is my past, and this must include my brains. Yet my mind bends towards the future. At long last, I've discovered that last lingering thing holding me back for all these years. It's the class I'm in, my caste. I finally figured it out. I must get over my class. In uncertain and tribal bunkers next to the remaining farm animals, just outside, we will huddle in warm, comfortable sheets and read on about kings and business tycoons, while the soothing rain, like a million dreaming monks strong, completes the sonorous moments stilled and foregone. And through the cracks, in reserved contemplation, as we consider the lords of creation. Thank you.
Thank you, Sergio. We're gonna go to the judges. We have a 8.75, 8.0, 7.2, 8.0, and an 8.2. Next we have joining us on the stage is Cleopatra.
Decisions. The Poetry Slam at Miami Loco. Which poem?
tie me up and ravel in rose, purple prose, drum, pulse, beat, drum, pulse, beat, drum, pulse, beat, tie me up and ravel in rose, react to the metronome, drum, pulse, beat, drum, pulse, beat. Tie me up, purple rose, purple leather ribbons, purple prose, purple leather ribbons, 3/4 inch wide, Giorgio Moroder rhythm, free verse, agitation, free verse, fascination, friction, felonious funk, felonious, monkey see, monkey do. Capture, rapture, capture, sweet, rapture, soft, strike, sweet. Tie me up in ravel and rose, purple, prose, drum, pulse, beat, drum, pulse, beat, drum, pulse, beat. Tie me up, reacts to the metronome. Reacts to the metronome. Saffron, soft, speak, rhythm. Saffron, soft, purple, crocus, rhythm. Saffron, rhyme. Saffron, scarves and chords. Lyrics, deliberate and delicate couplets, verses, deliberate and delicate. Whispered, spoken words, tie me up. Cufflinks, written handcuffs, links, line by line, time after time, skin to skin, word to word, heart to heart, tie me up, surrender me not, surrender you, rhyme, time out of mind, whiplash, crash, ecstasy, you to me. Words, fantasy, hide, seek, wanderlust, close your eyes, simply wish to be. It is not you that I fear. It is the fascination of you. Tie me up.
Judges, you know the drill. The scores are 9.25, 8.75, 7.0, 8.3, and 8.5. Those decimals, guys. Loving those decimals. I really like it. And the Cleopatra's score is 25.55. To give a round of applause for our next competitor, her first time competing on this stage, it is Moon Thomas.
Inside of them, because of the melodic guitar chords that warm the cool silence and are incidental tunes to the late night conversations. I'm safe. I'm safe because I've arrived at a place where friends are no longer interchangeable, passing characters in a picture book. They're the protagonists, the heroes, the wise old sages, the knights in shining armor in this novel we wrote with a common pen. My biggest fear is the binding of this novel we've written thus far coming undone, the pages burning, the ink smearing into illegible blobs of what were once memories. As the clock ticks on, the paradox follows suit. Life becomes more permanent and yet more temporary with every passing hour. Being a kid is no longer a valid excuse for the missteps. The memories have an expiration date. The words spoken become ever more difficult to erase. One day we left the playground and never looked back, and today we can count our remaining school years on one hand, and we've forgotten how it felt to swing on the monkey bars. Your friends, they're getting older too, their paths becoming more and more pronounced with each passing day. And try as you wish, there's little you can do to change the paths others carve for themselves. Memories fade. Growing walks hand in hand with forgetting. Time is the antagonist, cornering me into an inescapable labyrinth. All while holding our novel in one hand and a lighter in the other. I want to lock up these pages we've written together and never show a soul, never let them see the sun, because these pages are special. Because we each wrote our hearts in the story, because they are all compilations of all our disjointed pieces to create a unified novel bound with a single common thread. Because they are irreplaceable even if time manages to smear the ink. Perhaps, just perhaps, even if time manages to yellow the parchment or lift the pages from their sleeves, our story was still written, the moral still rings true, and our story is still ours to borrow.
Thank you very much, Moon. We have a 9.5, an 8.5, 9.75, and an 8.7. Going last only because she picked the sweatiest number that was in my hands that she had to choose from. Please welcome Jessica Doom.
Sometimes I think the stuff of imagination. With our hearts we yearn for the wild and vast expanse beyond, with our eyes we wander to its furthest reaches, and with our mouths we may even cry out in a moment of weakness, freedom, precious freedom. But with our very own hands we grasp the edges of the drywall, we drill the holes and we screw ourselves. Somewhere a ceiling shelters a houseplant who cries alone in the corner of a room, a puppet peering through the kitchen window, and one female member of the Lonely Hearts Club. My ceiling is great for taking the edge off, you know, that terrifying feeling that there is nothing between you and the great unknown. My ceiling allows me to determine the dimensions of my own life. Hope is a four-letter word that my ceiling protects me from. I protect my ceiling, and my ceiling protects me. But does it? If you press your ear against the wall and listen very closely, you might just catch a whisper of a different kind of beat. If you allow yourself to linger, the lapse of the beating current might just begin to rush upon your shore. But wait, you are still inside a house that you built, and your beautiful face cannot feel the crisp ocean breeze, nor breathe the salty air, nor awaken to the sunrise lifting you on its glorious wings. I still remember the moment when I realized I was Pinocchio, and I had been lying about who I was for my entire life. Every action and reaction carefully scripted, guided from moment to moment, place to place by the invisible strings that I thought were holding me up. Circa spring 2011, I drafted an email to some friends, roughly translated, I'm moving to the desert, tired of being a half-human, ready to cut the cord and come home. Quoted some Beatles, The Killers, Linkin Park, and P. Diddy, and left it at that. One friend responded, sounds like a cryptic suicide note. And in a way, it was. Pinocchio was doomed from that day when my feelings began to disintegrate. The beginning of a series of days and moments of cutting strings, falling down, and getting back up again. Of learning how to be a real boy. Ceilings are not real and puppets cannot grow whole, so dance and sing until the rains come down.
Thank you, Jessica. This is the last round of scoring for this round. Only five competitors will move on to the next round. We have a 9.4, a 9, a 9, a 10, and a 9.5. Which means that moving on to round two and another set of poems is Cassandra Davis, Laura Stenerson, The Apache, Moon Thomas, and Jessica Drew. We'll start once again at the top of the order with Cassandra Davis.
You sit quietly staring at the posts on the screen in front of you. People yelling, screaming, demanding justice, crying for peace, and you smile because you love this. This silent loudness that only comes from watching behind a computer, a keyboard, and watching as people bear and pour out their souls for others who have no voice to either take a chance and reply or smile. Frown, laugh, and scroll past it because they are too scared, too careful, to risk losing any sound if they throw it into this contrasting calamity that is a calm, scalding wave of people's opinions drowned by an abyss, and you don't tap out a reply because you are one of the fearful, one of the cowering dogs that hides behind a dumpster and doesn't whimper because they are too afraid of even being found out, even if it means getting help. But you wish, God, you wish that you could do it, that you could, both hands, all 10 stumpy fingers to the slick black keys of a clickety-clacketing keyboard that is just begging to be used to cry out, that you are tired. And you are lonely, and you are angry, because you never get to say those words. And for some reason, you want to force a reaction out of someone, anyone, but you can't bring yourself to, because you enjoy the silence. And you are scared that if you take that step, you will break it. And you will join the soundless noise that is a screaming voice of a social networking website, because even in real life, outside of these four walls that you closet yourself behind, you are quiet. Even when your friend notices the silent tears rushing down your face that have come from months of not telling anyone, not daring to say a word, not daring to even breathe out what might be a confession, because if you do, the silence will break. and that piece you tried so hard to imagine was there will break into so much fancy, and you can't let yourself get close to those who want to be friends, and it seems like you can only scream, you can only cry out, you can only sing some pitiful note that can't even begin to describe the storm that is rushing through your ears, to capture the thunderclaps that make up your heartbeat that is too loud when you don't have an audience. It is why you like the thumping bass when the screaming song's coming from your headphones, because you can pretend it is you. And still know at the same time that you are alone in your breakdown. You can turn off the music, come back to the silence, and you know that nothing has really changed. You are just a bit more calm, a bit more at peace with the way the world works around you, and you love it. Being able to hide yourself behind closed doors and way too personal drawings, knowing that you don't yet have to take that step and give away what little part of yourself you have left and somehow lose your voice in the process. Woo!
Start with our second round of competition. We have a 9, an 8.6, a 9, a 9, and an 8.8. Which is a 12. So that's minus 0.5 of a point. No, 2. No, yeah, that's right. I did it right. Everybody, I did it right. Thank you. Thank you. What? That's my name.
Oh, time.
Oh, yeah. I got that. Thanks, Dennis. Oh, I love it. Total score of 26.3. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the stage, Laura Stenerson. Woo!
You think about me out on the dance floor looking like a freak. I don't care what you think of me. I'm not doing it for you. I'm doing it for me.
Yeah.
So don't get so close. Stand back. And I don't want your advances. My body just moves like this when it dances. When that music goes, I just can't stop, and it's total, total abandon. But no, I wasn't always like this. No, no, no. I was a ballet school reject. I must have been 6, maybe 7. And I took a class, and oh, dancing with the other girls on stage in that leotard, those tights, and those little shoes, pink. Pink, not my brother's hand-me-downs, but my own beautiful clothes. And I was a beautiful ballerina, beautiful ballerina. But then the teacher talked to my mom, that bitch. And she told her, your daughter is ungainly and rather awkward. And she'll probably never be in Swan Lake. Well, I became the joke of the family. Klutz, Grace. And they just said it to my face. But the proof was there. All you had to do is look at my pants. Holes in every knee. No more church tights for you. Mm-mm, they don't last a day, and that's just a waste of good money. But inside, I was a beautiful dancer. But if I was wrong about that, if I was wrong about being a beautiful dancer, what else was I wrong about? It took a few decades to realize that maybe, just maybe, the reason I didn't know what the beat was is because nobody ever told me. And then, after those decades, I just danced. And now, I don't care what you think about me out on the dance floor looking like a freak. I don't care what you think of me. I'm not doing it for you. I'm doing it for me. Woo! Woo!
Woo! Time now to get those scores.
Wow.
Is that a one or a seven, sir? No, you're fine. We have a 9, a 10, a 10, 9.75, and a 9.75. Woo! I don't know if I am faster with the calculator. 29.5. Woo! It is time again to welcome to the stage Cleopatra. Woo! In her absence, I, for the audience, we'll move on to the next person. It's better that way. Ladies and gentlemen, Moon Thomas.
I want my life to be something profound. Profound adventures like jumping over a roaring creek and driving for hours and realizing that I'm the farthest from home that I've ever been. Surely, home will be there when I get back, but I question whether to take the leap. Will I float or fall? My uncertainty screams louder than the consequences. I want a life of profound love. When I forgot how to breathe because of your music in the air and the light in your eye radiating from the steady bass of your soul lit up like neon. Profound connections in the days on the couch and the nights on the phone, talking about nothing and everything all in a single breath. Teach me. Teach me your favorite colors, the food you eat on Sunday mornings. Tell me your fear of the dark. Tell me how it felt the first time you saw your mother cry. Tell me everything. Let your stories turn into threads and weave them with mine, and we can be beautiful. As you get taller, you begin to realize that family has been redefined. Eventually, you'll come upon your very own Independence Day. You're at the end of the road, and you look back at the village that raised you, and you realize that their hair looks nothing like yours. I lie awake tonight strategizing, negotiating, bargaining with the future that lies before me, praying that I can hold on to these precious treasures and this village that I've found. Shimmering in the Arizona sun, let them weather all odds that these treasures can withstand. Let us admire these things we built out of the raw lumps of copper. Maybe I will ascend a mountain and look at all the people with a radiance within them. Ponder the miracle it is that 7 billion people are all existing at the same time under the same reflective sky. I will look a little deeper at myself and see that life, the life I'm living and the life I'm existing within, are filled with stardust and treasures around every turn, all within our own profound world.
Thank you very much, Moon. We're going to go to the judges. We have a 9.25. We have an 8.9. We have an 8. We have a 9.25. and a 9.3. Woo. Very nice.
Very good.
And the computer says that that is a score of 27.4. Next up, next up, we are going to re-welcome Jessica to the stage.
Insides shift, grasping at faint outlines of a time before times. Meanwhile, sinking rays pierce the fault lines of an earthenware pot. The child steps outside to find a broken pot on his porch. He picks up a piece and mouths a prayer. Ashes to ashes and dust to dust. He holds the shard close to his beating heart as he looks out across the desert beyond. More broken pots and abandoned high chairs litter the lonely landscape. A deep breath sends boy forth in a cloud of dust. Thousands of crumpled papers are swept up with him in the storm. He reaches out to retrieve a wayward message. Dearest James, and another, I really think that this is the time we finally get it right. And another, there's gotta be more than this. And another, I wonder when Papa's coming home. When the dust settles, boy's dark round eyes raise to the heavens. The milky glow of the crescent moon cradles him for a moment, catching a few of his fresh tears. He bends over to look at his shard and his tender hands, bloodied from holding on so tight. A single salty drop lands on his fist. Then another, and then some more after that, and yes, still more. Steady stream of water and blood fertilizing soil and shard. Then a flash of fuchsia before exhaustion sets in. When the wolf awakens him again, boy peels his face from the sand to find it in the middle of a fuchsia feast. Bloom after bloom stretching out its silken arms, offering itself in a chorus of praise. How fiercely the life grows, bursting forth with every persistent heartbeat. So we build, brick by brick, brick by brick, brick by brick, while the world around us burns itself down.
To 9.5. And it's a 27.3. And now, without further ado, Cleopatra.
Okay.
incredible weekend in Miami, universe of dreams. It's a universe of dreams, positivity, dreams, positivity. Reality upon dreams, dreams upon reality. Ebb and flow, ebb and flow. What is it with this life? What is it with this world? What is it? Who is to blame? Who is the judge? Who is to be judged? The feeling is there, even after all these years. Who is found guilty? When is the game not a game? What is to be gained? Must you know your rights to know what is wrong? Must you dwell in the doorway of hell to unlock heaven's gate, to harness your dream? Must you harness your nightmare to know the difference, to jump to the other side? Must you know the other side? Must you reach the truth of despair, sadness? Must you endure the gauntlet in order to fathom defeat, victory? Must you experience the depths of hunger to value the feast? Must I know the now of the grand life to experience defeat? Is the condition of hardship meant to be the value to comfort you in the dark days and nights, meant to comfort you, meant to be the calm before the storm? Meant to be the calm before the storm, meant to be that uncertain key to open the heartaches, to unlock the heartaches, to unlock your heart of this element of today, this element, this heartbeat that evaporates today. The feeling is there, even after all these years. What is right? What is wrong? You know, we are here for a brief moment. 70, 80 years. The expanse of this infinitesimal cosmic slop that slams in your face. Unlock your heart. Unlock your heart. Unlock your heart.
To the judges. We have a 9.5, 8.8, 7.8, 7, and a 7.5. Only three contestants will be going on to the next round. Cleopatra's score of 24.1. Woo! Moving into our third and final round are the three competitors that I shall name now. Jessica Du. Woo! Laura Stenerson. Woo! And Moon Thomas. Third and final round with a poem by Laura Stenerson. Woo!
Well, I guess you already figured out I'm a teacher. Yeah. Woohoo! That's right. Yeah. Yep. I manage to get there almost every day. Yeah. And one thing I love to teach, even though I'm an art teacher, I still teach language arts because it's an art. So I teach personification, which is figurative language, and what it does is it gives human characteristics to an inanimate object. And I tell my students, you know, your phone, it doesn't love you. It does not love you, dude. No, man. No, it does not love you. What? They refuse to believe me. No, their phone loves them. Yeah, ding, ding. Yes, it does. Miss Tennyson, can I go to the bathroom? Yeah, why? Are you going to check your phone? Yes. Okay. Yeah. Addiction. You know, it's about that release of our chemicals, dopamine and serotonin. And every time you get a little ding, it releases some more of those hormones. Yes. And I was with a parent meeting. Yeah, all the teachers around and the moms. Oh. I try to hold it, but I'm probably not that good at that either. And so the mom is wringing her hands and she says, I just don't know what to do about him. He's causing problems at home too. And I'm thinking, I know what you can do. Take away that phone. And then there's the mom in another situation. And the whole time the child is sitting there looking dejected and mad, has that look on their face. Just hates the world right now. And there's mom. Yeah, I know. Yeah, problem at home too. And I'm thinking, I know what you should do. Put away your phone. Your kid needs some attention. Put that phone away. Now, an addiction, we think of it in many ways, but that phone, oh, wait a minute. I got 2 likes on Instagram! Yeah!
That's all I got for tonight.
A 9.75, a
9.9,
a 10, and a 9.
Woo!
Wow. Very good. Very good. Oh, no. Decimals. Too many decimals. And so is Laura, because her score is a 28.65. Remember that we are in the final round, our second poet of 3, and our final round is going to be Moon Thomas.
Share its bounty. That's a brand of paper towels. My heart is a paper towel, and you can choose your own size, whatever portion of me you'd like to unfold. A sheet of my heart can give you an awkward smile and an ineptitude for small talk. And a layer of my heart can give you jokes and redundant anecdotes that can fool a passerby into thinking that walls are nothing more than picket fences. Or, if you're lucky enough, you can unwrap me over and over until I am left as nothing more than a cardboard roll. What use is a cardboard roll? That's beside the point, or maybe that is the point. My heart is a paper towel. given a rhyme or reason because you need me and lost the day you forget. My heart is a paper towel, happy to clean up messes that belong to you or me or them or us or somewhere in between. The convenient picker-upper, that's me. Messes and my three-ply heart are truly works of tragedy without each other, because spilled milk begins to spoil without consolation from its clingy, absorbent counterpart, that's me. And what good is a brawny heart, that's another brand of paper towels, if there's no juice or tears or dog pee or ashes from the rubble of things we tried tirelessly to fix but crumbled anyways? Codependent? Probably. When my heart gets so occupied in something beside itself, it begins to lose itself. And when my heart begins to forget its own name, your words can tear through me like a wet paper towel when it's taken on just a little more than it can handle. It's a funny story because sometimes my paper towel heart feels like it's made of glass, because I've been chasing messes almost as long as I've been chasing my tail, and that's assuming those two aren't one and the same. I gravitate towards the wild, the arrogant endless cycles, the entropy, the messes. I'm a girl spongy with hope and ready to clean up mistakes until the day I become one. My heart is a paper towel, and sometimes you unravel me bare. I shiver without the walls of my defenses, but for you, I don't mind. It's a tragedy, but more tragic yet is the thought of us apart and my sheets being stripped to the roll and you not being there to love me anyways, because what good is a cardboard roll? What good is a cardboard roll? My heart is a paper towel, and I have but one request. Keep spilling your juice. Woo!
Thank you, Moon. To the judges. We have a 9.75, an 8.5, a 10, a 9.8, and a 9.8. Woo! It's going to be a very, very close competition here at the end. Number is 29.35. Wow. Our last competitor of the night. You know her by name. Yes. Household name.
Go Jess. Go Jess.
She's on her way to becoming a local celebrity. Give a stirring round of applause for Jessica Doong.
Running, and I remember the moment when we couldn't hold on to each other anymore. But I just knew I had to keep running, and I couldn't look back. Was hoping you were right behind me. But when I finally looked up, you were gone. I'm not sure if you took a back road or got lost somewhere, but I just wanted you to know that we were right. The lights were on and somebody was home. I got here safely like we talked about, and you know it's like we thought. The road does get pretty narrow in spots, and it's overgrown with brush, and it was longer than it looked, which meant walking in the dark quite a bit, though the moonlight helped. I sure got tired. But yeah, at the end of the day, it was a pretty straight road. You just can't. I mean, I hope you haven't. Please don't give up. I have no idea where you are or if you're getting this message, so I don't expect to hear back. But if you are lost, I know I got off road more than a few times myself. Just look up. The moonlight will carry you back to the old road, and the North Star will take you the rest of the way home. I got what I came for, and I wish I could stay, but I know it's not safe for me here. I have to keep going. So, goodbye for now. I truly hope you find what you're looking for. I have a feeling it's on the road.
Thank you, Jess. After that score is tabulated, we will be declaring a winner. We will be declaring the 2018 Miami Loco Slam Champion. That winner will receive a cash prize, which I did not mention yet. It's right here. I guess I don't have to mention it. Never mind. There's no cash prize. Don't be silly. And that poet will have the opportunity for a victory lap, reciting a poem of their choice. With all that in mind, we are going to go to the judges now. 6.95. Oh, no, that's the wrong number. 9.65. 9.5. 8.5. 8.75. And 9.8. It's going to be a very, very tight grouping of final scores. Can you feel the tension? I can. Because there's so, once again, I mean the decimals. Next year, no decimals. At this time, it would be appropriate to make noises not unlike a drum roll. Super close, everybody. The winner. 2018. One thing real quick. The Poetry Slam would not be possible if it wasn't for the Miami Arts Commission, Miami Artworks, the volunteers and coordinators of Miami Loco, and of course, Libby Rooney. So what are you guys doing after this? The winner, with a score of 29.35, the neophyte, Moon Thomas. Yeah! Moon, I hope you have another poem because the people want more.
I mean, more! I actually don't.
Freestyle.
Freestyle.
Okay. Somebody give me a topic. Someone give me a topic.
Oh, no. No. I'm gonna stop.
Yeah.
I'm gonna stop you.
All right.
Winning the jam.
What?
Winning the jam.
The jam? Like
the slam.
Strawberry jam?
The slam.
Oh. All right,
okay.
Well, I got nothing.
No, we want you to remain undefeated, so we're not gonna ask you to do it. Would you, of your other competitors, would you like to give them the honorary victory lap in your stead?
Yes, I would.
Of your, you can pick.
Let's see.
Of your choice.
I want to see what Cassandra has.
Me?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the stage. The honorary victory lap of Moon Thomas, as performed by Cassandra Davis.
For you.
Heck yeah.
It's a good thing I had a third one prepared. Thank you. Okay. I think I first fell in love with you, really fell in love with you, when your footsteps met up with mine and synchronized themselves to the rhythm of my beating heart, and your hand hanging above a precipice of questionings, should I take it? And superficial lyrics tied inside a mass of uncoordinating melodies, and your fingers were looking so perfect and long, and like they could fit perfectly inside the lines of my palms, and it wouldn't matter if they were sweaty, because you wanted to dance with me, and that was different. I think I started falling when we were assigned to a science class together, and you sat next to me, and with eyes that were so blue, and hair that was so long that I could never tire of watching it wave and curl down your shoulders. Your jokes were a rope for me, and I was standing on a chair that was broken and cracked down to the barest of bones, and your voice, which produced jokes and witty words, made me laugh and laugh and laugh, and the chair fell out from under me. After that, it was me standing on the tips of my biggest toes, trying my hardest to keep breathing, even as the rope closed tighter around the heart in my throat. One couldn't even begin to imagine how greatly terrifying it was, watching you laugh and following your hands as they doodled on the pages below you, without being able to breathe. And on the days when words spilled carelessly across the tables like rotted letters thrown onto the wood that would instantly start digging into the surface, I would just raise my toes up a little bit higher and say, "It doesn't matter, because it couldn't matter." The space between the soles of my feet and the ground below me kept growing taller, and the constraints around my neck and chest kept growing tighter with every passing day, with every little drawing you gave to me, and every little sarcastic remark you would say, and then it was gone. Just like that. Unwound. Untied. Free. And it was the worst feeling in my life. Knowing it was not just me, but it was me, that was the problem. My looks, my personality, no longer just the body that I was placed in and that allowed its crevices to be filled by my soul, but that exact soul. That was the reason for why the dance and the candles and the dolls and the little drawings and all the laughs you ripped from my throat were nothing. It was me. I think I started getting over you after you left. And I was able to slowly climb back up my chair and construct another rope that may or may not ever hang me as tightly. But sometimes, I swear to God, I can still feel your ropes around me.
Thank you so much, Cassandra. Thank you, judges, for judging this competition. Thank you so much for joining us this year. Hope to see you all next year.